I am part of the generation in Kerala who grew up with a lot of emphasis on socialist communist ideology. After the initial struggles of communism when communist party was established. And we are also the children of the liberalization and economic reforms program which Dr. Manmohan Singh started in 1991. So it's been a very interesting time for us where our childhood and school days and college days was re-emphasizing socialist communist ideology, whereas post-college it suddenly transformed into the liberal regime of economic reforms. One of the personal challenges, you know, I mean, I've been active in the student wing of Congress Party. You know, pretty much it's a two-party system, though it's two coalitions. And one of the challenges that I looked at that point in time is in the political, socio-political system that is Kerala, how can we work within the Congress Party constraints to try and take the steps towards liberalizing the regulations to attract investments. You know, the fact is that we grew up thinking profit is a bad word. So, at a personal level, I'll start with at a personal level. After my education, when I came back, I worked for a few years in Kerala with my family, and then I had the opportunity to work with two of India's biggest industrialists. One of you may have, while channel surfing, you would have seen this channel called ZTV. So they are India's biggest media group. So I got an opportunity to work with the founder of that, Subhash Chandra, and then later with Mukesh Ambani. In his take on. You know, that gave me an exposure to the corporate entrepreneurial effort which unfortunately has been lacking in Kerala. You know, I mean, big business is considered the villain and the bad guys. While working there, you know, I mean, I started addressing a few issues, and one of the issues I addressed was emergency service. Now there was no concept of organized emergency service. I'm pretty sure that, I mean, Nepal, few people have been talking whether we can get something done in Kathmandu. Malaysia has an ambulance service, organized ambulance service. I don't know whether Kyrgyzstan has an organized ambulance service. Do you have an ambulance service? Like what you see in 911 in Hollywood movies?
You don't have seen them now.
You don't have seen them. So in India also it was similar to that. So one of the things that I tried to do is pull together a bunch of friends, and I'm not talking about the project, I'm trying to communicate to you or tell you the thought process that went in the transformation of youngsters of my generation. All along it has always been the concept of the not-for-profit organization or a foundation running an ambulance service. But we were very clear when we started out with this, with one ambulance, that it has to be a for-profit structure which creates value for this all stakeholders, for the service, for the people receiving the service, for the people who are investing money into it, for the people who are running it. So that in the concept of charity, you know, you can do good work, but it's not charity. The reason being that a pure charity-based organization is not going to be sustainable in the long run. You know, I mean, you go seeking for, and I interestingly see that, while you have a not-for-profit arm, there's a consulting for-profit arm also in this. You know, I mean, that's the reality of the world. There is an element in the society where one has to address few things purely on charity, but where we can think of structure where there's sustainability built in, I think that is the way to go. Now, you know, I mean, I will not go further on that, but one thing I'll tell you, as a young I still consider myself young. But as a younger person, I didn't give too much weight to research. You know, I mean, I have been a pure play entrepreneur, gut feel. Okay, I'll get it done. You know what I mean? When it was about ambulance, is there a market? You know what I mean? The gut feel says that there's a market. So, would I engage a research agency? Would I engage myself in research? Yeah, I'll try to learn some things, but formal research? No. But I have to tell you that in the 20 years I've been working, my respect for research and more importantly, solid academic research has grown. And it's very important when one takes up project, either in the private sector, public sector, or which impacts policy making, to have it backed with underlying research. Especially in the area of public policy, because the policies that you tinker with or you introduce are potentially impacting millions of people, especially in a country like India. I mean, you change tax structure, you change the subsidy regime, you bring in an incentive program. It all has its impact. I'm proud to say, though I formally joined in the government only 4 days back, I'm proud to say that one of the first things that the current government did after coming to power a year back, actually on the third day after the government came to power, which has not been publicized at all, you know, we didn't go for the publicity, the Chief Minister has not mentioned it. One of the biggest challenges that Kerala faces, which is not emphasized, is the problem of alcoholism, mental health, and suicides. We tom-tom ourselves, we proudly say that we have the best social indicators, best health indicators, etc., etc. But in terms of alcoholism, we are pretty bad. We are either ranked the worst, you know, I mean, per capita consumption of liquors, either one or two. Second, mental health and depression, we are again ranked incidences number one or two. And in terms of suicides, per thousand, we are the number one. So one of the first things, on the third day after the government took charge, the CM actually, and I was working with him informally, pulled together a bunch of experts, including mental health experts. And we decided that we will get the best people in this area, including Vikram Patel, who work in London, with Stanford University, with Harvard University, and with some support from UN agencies. So very low profile, under the radar project. But, you know, I mean, the issue is very real. If people are committing suicide, there should be some problem, and at the numbers that's happening in Kerala society. So, I'm just giving you an example how an enlightened chief minister or how an enlightened political leader can think beyond and, you know, I mean, the normal and actually give emphasis on research. That project is currently on, but the downside of research is, you don't get results in a few weeks, especially a research like this. You know, I mean, it'll take at least 2 years for this study to be over, based on which we hope to address that issue at that time. You know, in the interim, some efforts are being made, but all efforts are based right now. Interim efforts are based more on gut feeling. So, my respect for policy is serious and very high, and when he called, you know, I mean, that's why I said it's an international group. I said I would like to come and meet you. I hope, you know, you got a chance to visit some of the places and experience some of what you saw in the video. You know, we are, of course, a God's own country. But, you know, we have these days when we forget that, like today, you know, we have gone on a hartal. Whatever be, it's a genuine issue, price rise, it is a genuine issue. But, you know, I mean, that doesn't mean staying at home is going to, you know, make any. But the difference I want all of you to understand is that 5 years back, if something like this happened, people, those who wanted to get out, could not get out because others would force them to stay in. That doesn't happen in Kerala anymore, which is a very positive change. With that, I would like to close my comments. And it was nice to know that, I'm also an alumnus of LSE. I was a Shelning scholar there. So, good to know that. And another thing, it's great that a center has come up like this. There's only, you know, I mean, and especially in Kerala, usually such centers tend to get headquartered in state capitals, where it's good to see this happening in Kerala. And I would like to, you know, I mean, I would like to open this for discussion and, you know, I mean, make it an exchange of ideas than one way conversation.
Can you comment to the question? Because even in the pro-capitalistic countries, health is one of the issues that is usually left for government. It's not really, at least in most, one of the sectors in my country that government has a huge role still is health. And for me, it's very interesting always to communicate with businessmen in the health sector. I would like to ask, what's, you know, your takeaway? How do you try to deal with this public attitude towards health issue and towards organizations working for profit in here?
Okay, so there are two answers to that. One is my personal private view. One is the government view. I have to be, you know, till day before yesterday, I could speak, you know, without worrying about that. The Kerala government. And this government's view is that health is a sector where the public sector needs to continue to play an important role. But one of the challenges is that efficiency becomes a problem. That is what is, you know, which we try to address with PPPs. So for example, let me give you a, you know, private view of the ambulance. It's not that India has not had ambulances in government hospitals. Since independence, probably thousands, tens of thousands of ambulances get purchased. It's allocated to a hospital. Why doesn't it run? It's simply the inefficiency which is in the system. Why? Because the day the ambulance is given and the driver and the EMT are allocated to the ambulance, the current structure such that it is in the interest of the driver and the EMT that the ambulance don't run. They don't run. As simple as that. Whereas when a private sector agency is selected and parameters are, performance parameters are provided, and there's no choice with adequate penalty being built in. So, my personal view is an ideal mix of public sector institutions competing with private sector would be an ideal situation. And that is what you see in Kerala, besides care institution. So an ideal mix is always the best. Going beyond Kerala, you know, NHS in UK was, in Britain was considered a system where 98% is state funded and state run. For several years it worked, but now inefficiency and cost overruns are actually starting to drag it down. That's the reality.
I don't know a little more about this ambulance service, how it runs, how it functions.
Okay, there are three models. How the ambulance service organization is built as it has three models. One is like a radio taxi company. You know, there's a control room which tracks the ambulance. It's placed all around the geography. And when a call comes, the nearest ambulance goes and responds. And the person, family or companion who transports, is transported actually pay like a taxi fare. That's a pure private plane. You know, you can call it a medical taxi. Based on the distance or the time or the medical service rendered on the ambulance, a fee is charged. Second is in partnership with the state governments, like the 911 service in US or the 999 service in UK, which is a centralized service. You call a number. The state actually funds based on a transparent bidding system, a tender system, and a private sector player runs the service. So in Kerala, there are two districts, Trivandrum and Alappuzha. This service is operating. And like in abroad, within 10 minutes, the ambulance comes. The third revenue stream for this particular organization, which I am involved with, is we run the ambulances for the hospitals. Yes, you know, I mean, it's like outsourced cleaning, like outsourced catering service, we run it. So we started with one ambulance 9 years back. It's now grown to around 980, spread over 6 states. And we don't transport dead bodies. That was the first decision we took. Ambulance is about saving life, not to transport dead bodies. Now, you may wonder why that decision. You don't understand, 95% of revenue of ambulances in the state of Kerala comes from transport of dead bodies. Because culturally, we were not tuned to calling ambulance to go to the hospital. You only think of an ambulance to bring a body back.
And what were the challenges? So when you started this, were there some challenges faced from the, let's say, hospital and not cooperating with your system? Let's say you bring and then you at least could transport the patient from one place to the hospital, but when you have to enter into the emergency services.
It was a challenge, but you know what helped was Supreme Court of India actually held in a major decision that not providing emergency treatment in an emergency situation is a criminal offence. So, I walking into a hospital with a family member, the hospital could deny treatment. But when we set up this ambulance service, this had a system of GPS tracking of the movement of the ambulance, etc. So, within a week of us starting, and by the way, I just want to correct, we didn't start it in Kerala, we started with the first one in Bombay. And in Bombay, when we started it, what happened was the hospital suddenly got scared that there is a trail. Electronic trail of bringing a patient which is left in the IT system, which can become evidence in if somebody were to go and file a complaint saying that treatment was not provided. So the hospital started following in.
That is what I was thinking. They could also kind of oppose because in the government.
They wouldn't. When they were taken in a 1298 ambulance, we have had probably less than 100 instances in the whole of 9 years where we were, our people were denied an immediate attention.
What about business sector in Kerala? Is it easy to do business?
Okay, it is easier.
Easier.
It is easier than the past. It is easier than the past. So, is it easy? It's a relative question. Is it as easy as in China? Obviously not. Is it as easy as in our neighboring state, Tamil Nadu? Not. But it is easier than before. You know, it was much tougher doing business in Kerala 10 years back. As time has gone by, it has improved. It is also improving in relation to other states. But a lot of it depends on the government in power also. So for example, when our party was in power earlier, between 2001 and 2006, we took the, then government took several actions where in the investment attractiveness of the state, Kerala came into the top three in India. Actually, a World Bank study said Kerala was ranked number two. But after that, it just fell to the bottom six. Now they are working very hard to change that perception and bring it back. In September, the government is organizing an Emerging Kerala Summit, bringing industrialists, investors together. We hope to change. One another important thing is that a government alone cannot change the perception of a state. The opposing party also has to be supportive of that. Because unless the government gets cooperation from the opposition, it's impossible to change the investment climate in us. Fortunately, the first 1 year, the Chief Minister has been, fairly comfortable in terms of the cooperation from the opposition.
But what's the difficulty? Because of high taxes, bureaucracy, or what?
So, if I rate the three most important factors which decide investment attractiveness, the number one, which specific to Kerala, is the legacy of militant trade unionism, militant labor issues in Kerala. Second is rather unfriendly bureaucracy, and which builds on a maze of regulations. So these are the two factors. See, you also have to understand that a friend from Nepal will understand that better. You know, we don't have the luxury that a Malaysia has had, or a China has had, or a Taiwan, or a Hong Kong, even Thailand has had in terms of implementing policies. Well, we are a constitutional democracy in its truest sense. I can stand here and as long as I'm a private citizen, I can stand and oppose the Prime Minister of India in the most vehement, non-violent manner, and there's nothing that's going to happen to me. The Home Minister of India, who controls all the intelligence agencies in India, there's one gentleman by the name Dr. Subramaniam Swamy who torments the Home Minister by filing lawsuits and cases. There's nothing. The state doesn't have, constitutional protection granted ensures that the state can't use its might against that. So, which is our biggest strength. But it has its weaknesses also. Fact is that if we have to acquire land, there are protections built in. If we need, to implement a project and a bunch of people together genuinely believes that it is environmentally not right, then they have the right to oppose it. We have to convince people, we have to bring them into buy into the idea, develop a consensus. So, it's complete. Professor Tarun Khanna at Harvard Business School has written a book, I forget the title, Millions of Democracy or something, comparing development in China and development in India. Every aspect, it's diametrically opposite. Sometimes when you wonder how development happened here, it's amazing how development happened. Last two questions, I have to leave.
Okay. I was thinking about, I also get really concerned about health services and similarly education and basic services of clean water. And I find these areas have run mostly on charity model, so welfare model, and no profit model. And that's why you also find the kind of irony that now with fuel transport, emergency model. Possibly this is a quick service, but I always wondered why, you know, the McDonald's or these pizza services can reach you, find you in 30 minutes and ambulances cannot. But similarly, are there other profit model ideas that you think learning from this health sector can be applied for education or water or electricity services?
So let's look at education in India. You know, I mean, it's such a hypocrisy that we call it not-for-profit. But let's say 90% of not-for-profit organizations engaged in education in India are actually for-profit behind the curtain. They take money out in one form or the other, except for the church or, you know, in Kerala, a couple of Hindu organizations. Everybody, you know, I mean, if it's, they will give it the title not for profit, but it's a money-making. So why engage it? You know, why, this is again my personal view, why for emotional comfort give it the name of not for profit? Why can't it be allowed in the for profit? And you know, whatever profit is made is genuine legal profit. But you know that it takes some time. I hope you know. I mean, it takes political guts also to address some of those. Right? So hopefully,
yes,
come
what is then the way forward
in education?
Yes,
in education. I don't think there will be political consensus in a state like Kerala for at least another 5 to 10 years for profit structures to come. So we will have to work within this constraint.
But after that, there is supposed to be.
No, I mean, there is, you know, people are changing, right? There's a bunch of youngsters who are graduating, and they are becoming the spine of the society, and so the society's thinking keeps changing. I'll give you an example. When my, you know, I mean, it's completely unrelated, but how the society changes, personal experience. My grandfather was hospitalized in 82. My mother, my aunts, my parents, uncles had to personally take care of him. And the societal norm was that. 15 years later, when my grandmother was hospitalized, yes, all of them were there, but having a nurse to support or assist had become acceptable. It was not acceptable earlier. Whereas at the same time now, even now, having somebody elderly admitted in a senior citizen home is unacceptable in India or Kerala. You know, I mean, it'll be seen as though, you know, I mean, it'll be received with horror and shock, right? My 12-year-old daughter, in a conversation, I scolded her for something. She turns back and says, "You better be careful, Dad." That she calls me Papa. "You better be careful, Papa. If you are nice to me, I'll get you a good nurse when you're old. If you're mean to me, I'll make sure that you'll have a bad and mean nurse." So see the transition happening. It's already happening, right? So don't have any expectations that I'll be taken care if I live to be old. Exactly. There's a transition happening. What was acceptable in for-profit or non-for-profit, the change is happening. The youngsters, it's much more, as long as the efficiency is there, as long as deliverance is there, people are willing to pay the price. The challenge for the government and the society is in that environment, how those who do not have access to equitable access are protected. And I think in that respect, both Kerala government and the federal government, UPA government and center, is actually the Right to Education Act, a very powerful act, right? I mean, from the nearby locality, 25% of the seats have to be actually blocked for people from below poverty line. You know, it's a very, very progressive act. Now,
but against the non-profit and self-sustainable model?
No, not really. So even if it were to convert into a for-profit structure, they could still continue with that, right? It's a principle of cross-subsidy. Why can't it be continued? It's an indirect form of taxation. But at least, you know, I mean, without the money being collected by the government and then routed back at the local level and the school level, it's through effective use of cross-subsidy, poor children will have access.
I have one more last question. We as a group, we did a small study here as a part of our curriculum, and our we tried to calculate illegality cost for street vendors here in Fort Kochi area. So I was thinking there are small such entrepreneurs, so one is big investment and small entrepreneurs who are trying to do something on their own, not much depending upon welfare models of the state, not accessing.
I have a question, illegality cost for legal street vendors or illegality cost for illegal street vendors?
We didn't find any.
There's a huge difference.
We didn't find any legal street vendors.
You didn't find any?
Yes, we with a random sampling we went and we didn't find. There was one which was 36-year-old license, and thereafter we got to know government simply stopped doing it. So what can be things to improve life at the bottom of the pyramid for the small entrepreneurs, such as street vendors? So, very sincere.
So, you know, I mean, one of the success models in Kerala, I don't know whether did you brief them on Kudumbashree?
Yeah.
So the self-help group model has been the, you know, I mean, it's a model which now UNDP has picked up and it's trying to replicate throughout their area of operation. So the only way we can look at it is through a self-help group system where, you know, I mean, they get together with a little bit of guidance and try and improve their standard of living. The illegality cost, I would expect there would be some illegality cost in Kerala, but my understanding, again, not my gut feel, you know, I mean, I would like to get a copy of this to read, understanding that it would be much less than in other states. So let me give you an example. You know, these industrialists and investors, when they come to Kerala, they find all these issues of labor issues and etc. etc. But everybody admits one thing about Kerala. This is a state where the illegal costs required to run an enterprise is the lowest in the country. Whether or not politician cannot extort money from you, this state is impossible. They may ask you for donation. If you think that, you know, I mean, you can walk up to an enterprise and extort money, it's very difficult. And it's getting more difficult now. There was, with this government taking proactive steps in police interventions and labor issues. So, I would assume, to be validated, I'll hopefully read your study, that the illegality costs. For example, the illegality costs in Delhi, it's like, you know, I mean, it's...
That is huge. But here also we found, and it has different, it is creating actually different dynamics because they are not paying directly, but in some sense unions have monopolized and they have their own regulation. They do not allow others to enter or grow up or move. Some who have been there, they have kind of created as their private property and they are not allowing others to do it, even if they are well off now, or many other things. So I was thinking just simply, few solutions to help poor people with this. Simply, Kochi Municipal Corporation starts issuing licenses, will has a larger impact on the livelihood of poor people. At the same time, will also, you know, break a little bit of too much of politics being in life of people here. Because then we found that the only way to become a street vendor would be you become a union member first, you please them. As they get their undefined role, and then only you will turn out, otherwise you will not.
Yeah, but you understand now, as a street vendor, without a location, there is no more you know, I mean, as long as you're not a nuisance for the society, there's no more license required. After the Supreme Court judgment in the rickshaw cases and all in Delhi, you know, I mean, where they tried to restrict it. It's only if you want a bung or a retail space in some construction that you require a license. Otherwise, innovative ways of, you know, I mean, inside building, you don't require a license.
But then there is an action for it.
If you require a construction or a bump. And that Kerala High Court has very, it's not, it didn't go away because on its own, there is a High Court ruling that public space cannot be given away other than through a transparent method.
Yeah. So I was just thinking few models.
The only model, only way they, I believe that they can strengthen themselves is through, you know, collective self-help group. Non-politicized self-help group. Where they, you know, I mean, strengthen themselves.